How would you do that?
Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for this time that we have to gather together, as brothers in Christ, and study the Word and study this book. Give us more insight into our Lord. Father, we would ask that you bless the food and bless those that prepared it. Father, we lift up Jane's sister from the motorcycle accident, and we lift up Tom, and we would just ask that you be with them, help them through this difficult moment. We pray for a clear skin for Tom, and we pray for Tom's whole family. You know, when just the mention of the C word, you know, brings terror to any family where it strikes. Father, we ask that our study today will be in honor and glory to you. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Mike, did you get a copy of the note? Are you on the mailing list?
Yeah, I get it on a digital copy. Yeah, I could look at that though. Have an extra one. Yeah, I got a digital copy though. I don't really. I can just look at it.
I'll look on the view here. Yeah,
that's
the next one. Yeah. Okay. Let's start with this story in Matthew. Matthew 15. The Elbridge is a trying to give us a
what chapter?
Matthew chapter 15.
22 to 28.
Well, actually, it begins at verse 21. We need to start with verse 21. This is up in the region of Tyre and Sidon, which is Canaanite region. This is not primarily Jewish. These are Gentiles, non-Jewish people. Would you want to start there? I'll read verse 21. We'll just read a verse around.
And Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon.
Sam, verse 22.
A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly."
Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us."
But he answered and said, "I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel."
She came and began to bow down before him, saying, "Lord, help me."
He replied, "It's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs."
"Yes, Lord," she said, "but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table."
Then Jesus answered, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. This is the way Jesus dealt with this woman. Elbridge suggested maybe we can get some insight into some aspect of Jesus' personality. To understand who Jesus really was and what he was about, we have to have his words, right? And that's what we have in the Bible. We have his words. But what we don't have is his tone of voice. We don't have his gestures. We don't have the expression on his face. We just have the words, don't we? They say that emails, for example, you have to be careful about emails and texting. You just have the words. And sometimes there's a lot of miscommunication through emails and texting because of the lack of this context of the nonverbal. Well, let's look at the words here. Let's start with the words. Now, this woman, interesting, she addresses him as Lord. But not only Lord, she specifies Son of David, which would indicate that she had some understanding of Jesus as maybe the promised Messiah.
Right.
Because the Messiah would come through the line of David, right? So she had confidence in him, apparently. In fact, at the end of the story, Jesus compliments her faith, her confidence. She was pretty sure this man is sent from God, God's Messiah, and he comes bringing healing and help for those who are suffering. And so she asked him, Son, have mercy on me, meaning have mercy on my daughter. If you have children, you know, you always, it's almost harder, the suffering for your child is harder than suffering yourself, isn't it? So this woman is really suffering for her daughter. Now, what Jesus' first response was, she was crying out repeatedly, apparently, and Jesus just ignores her. He's walking down the road. It's just like nothing going on. Just totally ignores her. And what would that indicate about Jesus? If you're asking him for help and you're crying out, and he doesn't even turn his head to look at you, much less answer you, what would that indicate about Jesus?
Didn't care about you.
Yeah, don't care about you. You're not important enough for me even to look at, much less to talk to. The disciples said, at least say something to her. Tell her to shut up. Tell her to get out of the way. She keeps crying. In other words, this was going on repeatedly. And the disciples were kind of getting tired of it. They said, get her. Get her out of here. His first answer was this: I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. What does that indicate about Jesus?
Mission focused.
Focus. Focus, and you're not part of my concern.
His priority was just.
That's not my job.
I'm not here to help you or people like you. But she came and knelt before him. Didn't give up, did she? She says, Lord, help me. Please help me. And then Jesus said something that's really shocking. It's not right. It's not right to take the children's bread and toss it out to the dogs. So now the question is, what does this mean? What does this say about Jesus? Is he saying, I look at you people just like I would look at a dog, particularly in the Jewish faith. You know, there's nothing but the Lord. That's another way of talking about somebody who is just absolutely worthless. You're not worth a piece of it. We would probably use a more vulgar term. You know, dogs. I think there's a verse, isn't there a verse at the end of Revelation where it says there are no dogs in heaven? I'm not mistaken about that. But it's not a reference to animal dogs. It's a way of referencing the people who are so degenerate that they're totally worthless. But I think modern translations have changed the word. King James, look at the King James Version for me, Larry.
Revelation 22:15.
Is it 22:15?
Outside of the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters.
Outside of the dogs.
Everyone who loves and practices false.
They're in a pretty bad company.
The worst of the
bad
worst.
Company.
For without are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whoever loveth and maketh a lie.
But it's in verse chapter 22 where he actually uses the word dog.
Yeah.
But to be clear, real dogs will be in heaven.
Yeah.
These all dogs will
have heaven. This is a metaphorical use of the word dog.
Just want to clarify that. Let me make it clear. Two-legged dog. Four-legged dog.
But that, you know, the dog, word dog was a metaphor among the Jews for totally regenerate and worthless. Mm-hmm. So when Jesus uses that word, that's you have to understand what the word literally, well, it doesn't literally mean, but what it means metaphorically when he does that. So does this response mean I am not here for the dogs? I'm not here for you who people, you Gentiles, who are totally outside the pale of God's mercy. You do not have God's love. You're not the chosen people. You're dirt. You're nothing. And it's not right to take what God has for his people, the food he has for them. It's not right to take it and to give it to you dogs.
I find that kind of surprising, because there are many instances where he's helped people who are not.
Yeah, it is.
You know, and
so it's out of character.
It's out of character. It's very out of character.
But it's not that out of character if you realize the purpose of the healings and stuff. The purpose of the healings were to bring people to repentance, not to actually help people. The purposes of the healings and the miracles and the signs were to demonstrate his power and stuff. It wasn't, otherwise he would have healed everyone.
They were just tools.
Exactly. It wasn't, the purpose of it was not to benefit those who were healed.
Well,
they did benefit from it. That wasn't the whole purpose of it. The purpose of it was to bring people to faith and repentance.
I'm just saying that there are a lot of instances in the Bible there where, like, you know, the centurion servant and others, where he clearly helped the people that were not the children of Abraham. And it just seems strange that in this case, you know, he's not, sounds like he's not interested.
Matthew 7 is similar to this. It says, do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to the pigs.
Yeah.
I think what Jesus did doesn't have that purpose in what the apostles did too in their healing. Those were signs that authenticate the message. So they do have that purpose. But I do think that Jesus' healing is a sign of the kingdom of God and of God. God's purpose ultimately is to heal us, to bring life and healing. That's his purpose for us, spiritually and physically.
That more spiritually than physically.
The death that was pronounced upon us in the garden, the curse, that's to be overcome, isn't it?
Only eventually, only in the respect that we're to be saved from death, in that we will live again, we'll be resurrected. Not that the people of God won't suffer in this life. In this life, there's still, there's still illness.
Right,
because we live under the curse.
When he first began his ministry, according to Luke chapter 4, after he had been tempted in the wilderness for 40 days and nights, Luke says he returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and he went to Nazareth. Take a little bit more here. Just a little bit. Not a little bit. That's fine. They asked him to read the scripture for the day, which happened to be from the book of Isaiah 61. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news. To preach good news. What's the good news? He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoner, recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's the good news. That God's salvation, God's healing, God's reversal of the curse, that's what I'm here for, to bring that about. And I think his work here on earth was just a sign of the ultimate, it was a sign of the kingdom of God. Now the kingdom of God, of course, is still not fully revealed.
Right.
But it will be. The kingdoms of this world will become the kingdom of God and of his Christ, book of Revelation, right? And what Jesus was doing was already the kingdom of God. He was God's king, and what he did was bringing the salvation, which means forgiveness of sin and the healing of our bodies and of our and the overcoming of death. So I think the healings were grew out of his compassion. God loves us. But like we hurt for our children if they're sick, God is expanding. This woman who's crying out, does God care? He does care. And his care and compassion is reflected. It doesn't seem to be reflected in the words of Jesus at first, does it?
No, it doesn't.
So let's get back to this. What does it mean?
Well, could it also, Bob, because he lets her keep going, and Sal had mentioned that Jesus was mission-focused, so was she. And he just wanted to maybe find out about her faith, because so often when he would do something like that, he would always refer to, I did this because of faith.
Did you have a waffle mic?
Yes.
So it's almost like he's testing your faith in him.
But how does he do that? How does he say these words?
You want some butter, please?
If he says if it means in a kind of stern, the voice, and with a look of condescension on his face,
But we don't know that.
No, we don't know.
Yeah.
So what? You have to assume that there must have been another tone in his voice, another expression on his face. Or was he testing her by really looking at her like she was a doll? And the tone of his voice manifested disgust. Did it go that far? It's almost
like that story in the Old Testament where the lady kept going to the king and requesting some justice, and eventually the king says, "Let her in because I'm tired of
hearing."
I'm tired of hearing. Right. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Which is what the disciples told Jesus.
Oh, no.
Get her out of here.
Thanks.
Yeah. So her persistence is what persuaded the king to finally listen to her.
Does the response, should it really be taken like, I do look at you like you're nothing but a father, I have no concern for you, and you shouldn't expect anything out of me? Is that the way it should be taken?
I don't think so.
So what would you have to assume?
That's very inconsistent with...
What would you have to assume about Jesus' gestures, or tone of his voice? What do you think it, what do you think it means? How would you say it? It could mean something different.
Maybe he's teaching his disciples how the Jews were very prejudiced people, especially to Gentiles. And maybe he's showing them this is how you view these people.
Well, yeah. Well, is it possible that Jesus says something like this? Now, with a smile, he turns to her, and with a smile, he says, "Well, it really wouldn't be right now to take food from the master's table and give it to the dogs, would it?" Sound like with a question mark. The tone of your voice can indicate whether you're making a statement or whether it's a question. It's not right to give food to the dogs. That's a statement. It's not right to give food to the dogs. That's a question. So, is it kind of in the form of a question? With a smile on his face? As if a little bit of a teasing her, just a little bit. How are you going to answer that? I'd like to know your answer to that. So, if it's somewhat of a question, teasing her to try to pull something out of her, rather than just a flat statement. Get out of here. I don't have anything from you dogs. But maybe he said it that way, which would be even a stronger text, wouldn't it?
I think that's correct of what you're saying. When he knows her heart, and when he talked to her, by her reaction, he was asking her a question, just like if she were to go, if he were to, like he was looked to as like a rabbi. She knew that he was a Messiah. She called him the Son of David. He knew her heart. So when he talked to her, she responded, and you could tell by the way that she responded, if he talked to her in vain, her response probably would have been different. Which I don't think he talked to her in vain at all. I think he asked her as a question, just as if he was getting her to question her own heart.
Well,
you know, to think of herself.
Well, I think it is possible to look at it either way. And I suppose that either way it would show something true about Jesus' personality, that knowing her heart, that he could have said it in a very stern way that would indicate, you know, that on the surface, you know, apparently he thinks she is nothing but a dog, giving her the most difficult test to be imagined that, you know, ordinarily would make a person feel so embarrassed and humiliated. You know, I don't want to talk to this. I need to get out of here. You know, that she completely, you know, made her feel ashamed of even coming. Maybe he did that. But there is another way of taking it. I suggest if you look at some other passages, Luke 13:32, while you guys are reading, I'll just read this. Here's another saying of the word of Jesus. I need to be in Luke here. The Pharisees had come to Jesus, and they had said to him that he needed to go somewhere else because Herod wanted to kill him. And Jesus said, "Go tell that fox, I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. Go tell that fox."
Yeah.
"I will drive out demons and heal people." What do you assume about the nonverbal aspect of demons communication? Calls him a fox.
You think of a thief. Fox is steal.
Yeah. Yeah. Very sly.
Like chickens and
cunning. An indication is, "I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day."
Foxes are opportunistic predators. Mm.
In Luke 9:60, here's something a little even, this is even a kind of a shocking thing. Jesus said, a man said to him, he was walking along, a man said to him, "I'll follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to another man, I'm sorry, verse 29, he said to a man, "Follow me." But the man said, "Lord, well, let me first go bury my father." I guess his father had recently died. And Jesus said, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." What kind of child, his father has died, and he's not going to lift a hand to see about the burial or the funeral? He goes off on some kind of other mission. Is that what Jesus said? It sounds on the surface like just saying, you owe no respect at all to a dead parent. And let the dead bury the dead. What does that mean? How can the dead bury the dead? How do you think this? Well, I know you're eating, so it's hard to talk.
That's a hard question.
I think he's telling the man that it's a high cost to pay to be his disciple.
And you have to decide on your priorities. What's more important, your family or the world? Proclaiming the kingdom of God, in other words, following. Are you going to really follow me? Are you going to really be a part of my ministry? What's your priority here? It's like, I guess, if there's a war, are soldiers sent home to bury their parents in the middle of a battle? You know, if they're in a place where there's no active fire, if the battle is raging, they don't take a man out of the front line and send him home on furlough for his father's funeral, do they? Jesus is saying, you know, you're in the front. There's something more important than engage here.
I think, too, in some of these cases, Jesus often refers to himself as the bridegroom. And some of these lessons are specifically applying to the fact that he is there now, and he has a specific mission, and they need to be focused on him and his current mission.
And that would be a similar, you know, to this saying that is so shocking. If you're right, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better to enter life maimed than with two hands going into hell. Which is better? To go to hell with two hands or to be saved with one? But Jesus has a way of what we use of hyperbole, a way of exaggerating to drive home a point, doesn't he? But the point that Eldridge is making here in this chapter here, it's called the missing essential in understanding Jesus. It's his personality. Do you have to experience someone's personality in order to love them? I've got the word live. Here's that part. It's love. Do you have to experience someone's personality in order to love them? He makes that statement. I got thinking about that. You have to experience them personally in order to have affection for them. And is there a difference between loving someone and having affection? Liking something. You know, there are some personalities that are likable. We hear this talk today about presidential candidates. Some are likable, and some are not so likable. If you look at, say, the personality of Tim Scott, very, very likable personality. And compare that with DeSantis. DeSantis is a little more, you know, and he's been called kind of a rough edge. They say his wife, you know, is the opposite. She's the one who's very, very charismatic and likable. But that's, it's true with people. It's, some people are very approachable and likable, and some make you feel like you just kind of stand off a little bit. It's not that you think that they're bad people. So, I'm wondering, do we really have to know experience his personality? And is it even possible? We've got these words here. The more I've thought about what he says here, the more I'm kind of wondering about that. But people like to imagine Jesus' personality.
That's because we like to imagine his personality is similar to ours.
Well, but what we have an idea of what we want his personality to be. And so, of course, the artist tries to put that in his picture, doesn't he? And so I just went online and found some pictures, you know, various pictures. This, the small one here, is one that's very, very famous.
Yeah.
I see it a lot. This one here. Right?
They all look like Northern Italians. Why is that?
Yeah. But here is Jesus.
I'm good.
You're not looking at him head on. He's looking up here at the side. What does that seem to say about his personality? He's kind of looking up. What does it say about his personality? He's kind of focused on something heavenly. It has got.
That's what you think of.
It's definitely not.
But he's very calm. Right?
Yeah.
He's just very calm, peaceful.
Yes, it was.
You see these statues of Buddha. Of course. The Buddha has always got this serene calm. There's even a little bit of the way this is kind of pictured in Jesus, this serenity he has. That's his basic personality. Very calm, cool, and collected. Unperturbed.
Because his belly's full.
Well, I don't know.
When you look at Buddha, that's what you think about it, and big belly. So much his face.
Yeah.
The one on the left hand side there where he's holding the little lamp. Looking around.
That looks like compassion.
Here's a
caring.
Here's a very soft soft and caring, empathetic.
Right.
That doesn't come out so much in the next picture. Look at the one on the far right where he's looking at you. What kind of personality do you have there?
And look into your soul.
His eyes are looking right straight at you.
Very focused.
But all of this, this imagination about what he looks like and about how he talks, all of this nonverbal, we just don't have it, do we? We have to imagine it.
Yeah.
We have to make it up in our minds, don't we?
And therefore, we have to be very careful.
We have to be very careful about making an image.
Because what I imagine may not be what Bob imagined.
Exactly.
And in the end, what matters about Jesus is what he did. He said, I came to give my life as a ransom for many. What did he do? He gave his life, didn't he? In the end, that's what matters, what he did. And in the end, you know, if you look at, to come even back to politics, what really matters is not whether your president is likable or not, his personality is smart, but what does he do?
Right, exactly.
What are his executive actions? That's really more important than whether he's got a nice smile on his face or whether he goes around kissing babies all the time. What does he really do?
I think too, if we truly feel that scripture is inspired, okay, that scripture is God-given, then we have to appreciate the fact that God has given us enough to understand who Jesus was, and he's given us the important things to understand. If he wanted, just to take an example, if he wanted us to think of Jesus as being playful, he could have written, you know, he could have given us some instances where Jesus was playful. Okay? But if we don't see that in Scripture, then maybe that's not that important. Maybe that's not significant. Not that he might not have been on occasion, but maybe that's not significant as to what we need to know about Jesus and his mission and what he's done for us.
But I think what Elgin is trying to say is that maybe if it is bad to try to assume something like that he's playful, that the scripture doesn't make clear, it's also bad to assume that he never could, be playful, that he was always the kind of person who could never enjoy joshing with his disciples or anybody else in any way whatsoever. You don't want to look at Jesus as absolutely unresponsive to anything that was enjoyable. You don't want to go the other way either. And it seems like what Eldridge is trying to do is say, you know, that we do have this picture of Jesus that is probably inaccurate. And he's trying to show that there are some things in Scripture that we'll see later in the book when he talks about a passage that he thinks could be interpreted. But again, it's an interpretation. It's not something that explicit. He believes, for example, on page 16, he believes in the book, he points out that he believes that Jesus was in some ways playful, brilliant, witty, irreverent, cunning, and impatient. There was some aspect of his personality that could be described as playful, brilliant, witty, irreverent, cunning, or impatient. And he's kind of saying those are aspects of his personality that we people have never thought of before.
I guess I've never experienced any place where I really thought that Jesus seemed to be irreverent. Other than the others,
Well, if you think of what it would be to be reverent, is it really a very reverent thing to say, don't worry about burying your father? Is it really, if you were a Jew, an Orthodox Jew, a pious Jew, is it really a very reverent thing to say, Don't worry about whether your hands are clean before God before you eat.
Yeah, reverence towards what?
Yeah.
Irreverent. I mean, he was irreverent towards a number of things about the Jewish.
The rules that the Jews made.
The rules, and also the Pharisees, the leaders of the Jewish.
Right.
He wasn't really respectful to them. You know, that could be considered.
He was very disrespectful towards them.
Called them serpents and whitewashed caskets. I mean, that certainly
that's true.
Would be considered. It is time an irreverence of sorts.
He didn't seem to have much concern for what other people thought he was doing. The rules that were made up by the religious leader of society, what was considered to be, you know, a respectful Jew in that time.
It's another example how the gospel confronts culture. And all over the world you have different types of culture, and somewhere the gospel is going to confront something in that culture. Like in Africa, it's funerals. Funerals are two of the most important days in most Africans' lives are weddings and funerals. And people attend funerals even of people they don't know, but that person is from the same village. So they feel obligated to go.
Jesus says,
let the dead bury their dead.
He would ignore that kind of obligation.
He
would speak lightly of it, right?
Yeah.
How would the Africans interpret that passage where he said, let the dead bury the dead?
They don't like
follow
it.
Me. Don't even worry about your own father's funeral.
Right. They don't like
it. How would they deal with that?
They kind of skip over it.
Put him in the roasting pit.
They don't like it.
I think we're all pretty good about skipping over different
Well, sometimes they'll even not have a church service on Sunday because there's a funeral. So they prioritize funeral over the church gospel.
Yeah.
So it's tough to.
Yeah. Well, this book will at least get you to thinking about, I guess it's sort of impossible to kind of imagine. You make up in your mind something. Kind of image of what Jesus was really like, personality-wise. But sit us up and realize there may be aspects of Jesus that are different from what we might have imagined.
Yeah, I've always thought of Jesus as being a very focused personality, and serious, I guess, is a
very short.
Yeah.
I think one of the lessons we can take from this is that we have to be careful to think that we know the whole man.
Yeah.
That we really know every aspect. We know what's the phrase? What would Jesus do?
Yeah.
I think in many cases we don't know.
That's right.
What Jesus would do. In the case of the woman, where he tells her, this isn't for you. You know what I'm teaching now isn't for you. We wouldn't normally think that would be something Jesus would do.
Yeah.
And I think one of the key things is there are aspects to every person. And just as he was fully divine, he was fully human, and you wouldn't presume to know somebody that you just read about. Like, say you read a biography of a president or something, you wouldn't presume to know exactly every aspect of his personality from
him. That's true.
And I think we need to appreciate that. And not think we would know exactly how Jesus would handle every situation. We try to put him in a box, like we put Bob's got in my mind, Bob's in this box, Sal's in a different box. But we can't do that because.
And somehow Jesus' box looks a lot like our box.
There you go.
We like that. It's a comforting thing.
Yeah. That we are a lot like him in many ways.
Our box doesn't look like him. It's not a two-way street.
But in the next chapter, he does ask the question, is Jesus really playful? So he asks us to kind of consider that. Is there some signs in somewhere in Scripture that you could answer that question in the affirmative? So we'll look at that next week.
We have programmed The Chosen to show the miracle where Jesus turned the water into wine and was at a wedding. And as the wedding goes, people are getting pretty joyful and they're dancing, and Jesus is dancing with them, having a good time. It was good to see. Because that's not how you picture Jesus.
Yeah. You know, and if it weren't for the little bit of scripture we have where he goes to Lazarus' grave and he's so overcome,
right,
you know, by the grief of Martha and Mary that he cries and stuff like that. If it weren't for that little bit of a passage right there, we normally wouldn't think of him as being that, not that, we wouldn't think of him as being emotional, yeah.
That
we wouldn't think he's compassionate, but yeah, we wouldn't think he would be that emotional. We tend to think
right
of him more stoic, okay? So I think scripture gives us that little bit to remind us that he was human. There were emotions.
Like to play with kids,
even though he knew that he was going to raise Lazarus,
right?
And that her grief,
he saw their pain.
Was going to be,
yeah,
he was going to take care of her grief,
right?
A little bit. Nevertheless, just seeing her grief, it was her grief. It was not so much that he cried because Lazarus was dead,
right?
He cried because of the. Just seeing, you know how it is, sometimes you go to a funeral and somebody that you weren't very close to, but you see the family members leaving, and it just moves you very deeply.
And even though in those cases we know that that person knew the Lord and that they're on to a better place and stuff like that, that doesn't mean you don't appreciate the pain that the family is going through and missing that person, missing the opportunity to be with them.
Okay, and then, anything else for the good of the group?